need magnesium for the aluminum to react? Will the aluminum react alone by itself?
Yeah,
sure. So, no problem. It just so happens that there's magnesium present in addition to the aluminum. Magnesium is going to react, you know, this as well. This is what we call a single replacement reaction, or redox reaction. It has a pattern, A plus BX. And so this is our A plus BX yields. This would be AX plus B. You seen this single replacement? Yeah. And so we can predict what's going to happen with magnesium based on this pattern. Now it's going to be magnesium solid plus HCl. This is A plus BX yields AX. So magnesium with chlorine or chloride. Now, what's the formula for magnesium chloride?
MgCl2
plus hydrogen. Hydrogen, atomic hydrogen is not stable. We like to form diatomic hydrogen, which is stable. So this is two HCLs. Goes to two hydrogens. This is very similar to the iron. You know, iron goes to plus two. Magnesium goes to plus two. So it's two HCLs here. This is a hydrogen gas. This is aqueous. This is aqueous. Pretty soon, I'm not going to bother writing aqueous. But I will write solid and gas.
Question. That's only one hydrogen.
Oh, yes. It's only one hydrogen. Sorry. So let's.
Well, the first chemical reactor doesn't have H2? Is it a single hydrogen?
Yeah. No, this one has H2 hydrogen.
Oh, okay.
So both of these produce hydrogen gas. Both of these produce different amounts of hydrogen gas. And so based on the amount of hydrogen gas produced in the mixture, we can actually figure out what proportions of magnesium and aluminum we have. It's just because they, you know, if this sample were pure magnesium, we'd generate a different amount of hydrogen than if it were pure aluminum. And so based on that. So this is tricky because, you know, it would be easy. If we had, let's say we had a 0.155 gram sample, and we knew it was 50% aluminum by mass, 50% magnesium, then, you know, we'd divide half of that. That would be the number of grams of aluminum. So we could go grams of aluminum to moles of aluminum, moles of aluminum to moles of hydrogen, grams of hydrogen. And the same thing with magnesium, but we don't know how many grams of aluminum. You know, we just know how many grams of mixture. And so we're going to have a 0.155 gram sample of magnesium solid and aluminum solid. And how much of each of those, we don't know. And so what's the easiest way of solving this? I think the easiest way is a graphical method. You know? By far the easiest. You know, that way we don't have to think of multiple equations, multiple unknowns. This is a pain. And the quickest way is for sure graphing. You know, on the test, you know, I notice, you know, people who do it graphically finish much faster than people who try to do it algebraically. And so what do you do? Let's just talk about the strategy. What do you do here in the graphical method?
This one's 100%.
Yeah, 100%. So all we do is we assume this is 100% aluminum, let's say. There's no magnesium in there, so how many grams would that be? 0.155 grams of aluminum. So if we go 0.155 grams of aluminum to moles of aluminum to moles of hydrogen, and then moles of hydrogen to grams of hydrogen, then we figure out how many grams of hydrogen we get from that. If it matches this amount here, let's say it, you know, if we assumed it's 100% aluminum and we get this many grams of hydrogen, then it's got to be 100% aluminum, because if there's magnesium in there, we get a different amount of hydrogen. But if it isn't, then we should check to see. Maybe it's 100% magnesium, right? Does this make sense? And so this 0.155 grams would just be a pure magnesium, and then figure out how much hydrogen. And so now we have the two extremes. The two extremes would be 100% aluminum, 100% magnesium. Is it one of those, or somewhere between? Turns out it's somewhere between. And it doesn't match either of those, and it's somewhere in the middle. And so we got to find out where it is in the middle by graphing it and coming up with the equation and trying from there. So is that enough, or do you want to go through and finish.
We can finish.
Finish the whole
like
thing.
Thank you.
We can finish the whole thing. So, but you know, this is stoichiometry. So, in stoichiometry, you know, the center of the stoichiometry. Now, stoichiometry. Do you know what it means? It means mass relationships or amounts. You know, relationships between amounts and chemical reactions. At the heart of it is the mole relationship or the mole ratio. So we have the mole ratios here for the balance equation. And so what we're going to do is we're just going to do this. You know, first assume 100% aluminum. So we're just going to border it. You know, it's going to be somewhere between probably. So we're going to get 0.155 grams of aluminum. And then we just do a gram to mole conversion. So I don't have the molar mass of aluminum memorized. We use it off the board. 26.98 grams of aluminum per mole of aluminum. And then there was this, what was it? What was the ratio? Well, it's right there. 3 moles of hydrogen to 2 moles of aluminum. So this will give us moles of hydrogen. Now for hydrogen, I do have it memorized at 101, but I'm not going to use 101 because that would only give me three sig figs. So 101 times 2 would be 202. So I'm going to use 4 sig figs. And so I'm going to get 2016, you know, because it's 1008 to 4 sig figs. So I'm going to go 2016 grams of hydrogen to a mole of hydrogen. This is the only time I'll go beyond 2 decimal places. Because if I only want 2 decimal places, I get 202, which is 3 sig figs. I want 4 sig figs. Yeah. And so let's figure out how many grams of hydrogen, if this sample were pure aluminum. So I got, let's go with it here, 0.155 divided by 26.98 times 3 divided by 2 times 2.016. If this sample were pure aluminum, I'd generate 0.01737 grams of hydrogen gas. Yeah. But I generated 0.016, you know, and so I generated more hydrogen than, actually, no, this would generate more hydrogen than I got. And so this sample cannot be pure aluminum. I only got 0.016, I only got 0.017. Okay, so let's go to the other extreme. The other extreme would be assume, and I don't have to do this in any order. I could have started with magnesium first, it doesn't matter. 100% magnesium. I only started with aluminum because the equation was given in the previous problem. So if I go 1.155 grams of magnesium, and then a mole of magnesium weighs how much? 24.305. You know, for this we'll do intermediate roundoffs. Now for molar masses, I'm going to round it to 24.31 because that's how the other ones are generated in the shorter tables. They do round off here. And so I'm going to do the same so that my molar masses matches the ones that you'll see in other pair of tables. And so I'm going to go 24.31. I could carry extra digits, but it's okay. I'm 4 here. I only have 3 here for my given. So I'm all right. And then I know that there are 1 mole of H2. Mole of H2 gas per 1 mole of magnesium. So. Then again, 2.016 grams of hydrogen per mole of hydrogen. That'll give me grams of hydrogen. So let's figure out how many grams of hydrogen I'm going to get. Okay, 0.01285. All right, thanks. And so this sample cannot be pure magnesium either. You know, it looks like it has more of which, aluminum or magnesium? It looks like it has much more aluminum because the amount of hydrogen I get is much closer to that of pure aluminums than of pure hydrogen, I mean magnesiums. So my guess is it's much much more aluminum. Now this is much more aluminum.
Is that why they're asking about magnesium?
It's okay. We could do either, because if we know it's 100% aluminum, then it's 0% magnesium. Mm-hmm. You just got to add up to 100%. So we could solve for whichever is more convenient, whether it's percent aluminum or percent magnesium. I would say percent aluminum is more convenient. Why? Even though they're asking for percent magnesium, I'm going to solve for percent of aluminum because
it'll
give me a positive slope. The reason I'm going to solve for percent aluminum is this. If I put percent magnesium here, the higher the percent magnesium, the less hydrogen I generated. That's going to give me a negative slope. Whereas if I put percent aluminum here, the higher the percent aluminum, the more hydrogen I generate, which will give me a positive slope. So if I write the total grams of hydrogen over here, that's from both aluminum and magnesium, the total grams of hydrogen, well, if it's 100% aluminum, then I'll get 0.01737. And so here is the 0.01737 grams of hydrogen total. And if it's 0% aluminum, then I'll get this amount here, which would be 0.012859. I only need, it's not 9, that was a G, sorry. 0.02185 grams of hydrogen. This is grams. Now, this is a linear relationship because no squares or anything else like that. So we just plug it in to figure out the equation. It's going to be y equals mx plus b. Y is the total grams of hydrogen. So grams of hydrogen, so we call y grams of hydrogen, is equal to m, the slope. So this delta y, 0.01737. Minus 0.01285 delta y, which would be grams of hydrogen, it's a unit, over delta x, which is 100 minus 0% aluminum, times x, which would be x percent aluminum, plus the intercept, which is 0.01285 grams of hydrogen. So we'll just solve for x percent aluminum here. X percent aluminum is equal to y grams of hydrogen. Well, y is going to be 0.0163. That's what I got there. That's 0.0163 grams of hydrogen minus the intercept here, which would be minus 0.01285. This is grams of hydrogen. Divided by the slope. The slope here is... figure out the slope. 0.01737 minus 0.01285 divided by 100. I'm not going to write this in scientific notation. I'm just going to go quadruple 04520. And the units for this would be grams of hydrogen per percent aluminum. So if the units, if you look at the units, the grams of hydrogen cancel, and then we invert and multiply, so it'll be percent aluminum. So I'm just going to invert this times 0.0163 parentheses, 0.0163 minus 0.01285 close parenthesis. 76.32% aluminum. So that makes sense. It's a higher percentage of aluminum. And subtract this from 100, which would give us 23.67% magnesium. So this is a lot easier, I think, than solving a system of equations. What do you think? How can we check the answer? Yeah, we can check the answer easily. If you want to check the answer, we just do stoichiometry. You can check the answer by just solving this the other way. Solving this the other way is, if we have 0.155 grams of sample, and it's 76.32% aluminum, that means there's 76.32 grams of aluminum for every 100 grams of sample. Does that make sense? And so this we can use to figure out how many grams of sample we have. I mean, how many grams of aluminum we have in that sample. And then we can convert this to moles, 26.98 grams of aluminum per mole of aluminum. Then we can convert that to grams, 2 moles of aluminum for 3 moles of hydrogen. And 2.016 grams of hydrogen per mole of hydrogen. This gives us the grams of hydrogen from aluminum. And then we do the same thing. We know that the rest has to be magnesium. So we could either do, you know, subtract, or we could just go ahead and multiply, you know, 23.67 grams of magnesium per 100 grams of sample. So these two should add up to 100, which they do. Sample. And then et cetera, you know, moles, grams, and then we get the grams of hydrogen from magnesium. And then we add these two up. You know, the sum of these must equal 0.0163 grams of hydrogen total. So we can do two separate, you know, these two separate reactions produce different amounts of hydrogen, but we can't tell which hydrogen came from the aluminum and which hydrogen came from the magnesium. And so we just have the sum total of the hydrogen here that we measure. Does that make sense? This is the way. In fact, this is just your standard stoichiometry. So going the other way is even easier. You know, if we have the unknown mixture, and and the percent composition, then we can figure out the total grams of hydrogen. Fairly straightforward. And so let's take a look at chapter 4. You know, chapter 4, all these topics are, I think, a review. You know, section 4.1, write balanced chemical equations. That's pretty review, right? 4.2, do mole-to-mole conversions to solve stoichiometry problems. 4.3, determine the molarity of a solution. You guys are familiar with molarity? Molarity is just a different type of mixture. This is a mixture of magnesium and aluminum. oftentimes what we'll have is we'll have a mixture of water plus some other solute, you know, like sodium chloride or whatever else. And oftentimes the easiest way of representing that composition is by molarity. We'll come back to 4.3. A 4.4, define limiting reactant, excess reactant. Do you guys remember that, limiting reagent problems? 4.5, theoretical yield, percent yield, actual yield. Does that ring a bell? No. 4.6, express changes in amounts based on limiting reagents. In other words, you know, when we look at these topics here, these are all pretty familiar. Stoichiometry, solution stoichiometry, etc. And so I'm not really going to talk about the topics. We'll just look at some sample problems. How about that instead? And so we deal with mixtures. You know, we have different kinds of mixtures here. But we often deal with mixtures. All we need to know is the composition of the mixture. And we can figure out the stoichiometry. And so at the heart of the stoichiometry, it's just the mole-to-mole conversion, moles of A to moles of B. And so we just need the mole ratio. So we need some kind of balanced chemical equation. So balancing is tedious, but eventually you should be able to get the right answer. And so just a mole-to-mole conversion. And the easiest is if we don't have a mixture. So for example, if we have grams of pure A, that's simple. If we have grams of pure A, then we can go to moles of pure B, and then go to mole-to-mole conversion, and then we can go straight to grams of pure B. But in Chem1A, oftentimes we're dealing with a mixture, so we might have A and G, you know, like aluminum and magnesium. If we have a mixture, then we have grams of A mixture. And so let's say it's 75% aluminum. Well, if we only have 75% aluminum, then if we have 100 grams of mixture, we'll only have 75 grams of aluminum here, not 100 grams. So what we need is a percent composition by mass. So we could do that for aluminum here, and then we could repeat it for magnesium, you know, whatever else we have as a separate stoichiometry problem. Get that. But there are other units that we use. You know, percent composition is for fairly concentrated mixtures. Sometimes we have other units other than percent that we use. And so percent let's look at composition by mass. Just like we have other units that we use. For example, if I have a sample that weighs 0.060 grams, I could say, oh, that sample weighs 0.060 grams. But we have other units that might make your life more easier or more difficult, depending. Rather than saying I have 0.060 grams, you know, like this, 0.060 grams, I could just say I have 60 milligrams. Now, sometimes this is easier to say. Or what if you had a sample that's 0.000060 grams? You know? Well, if I had a point quadruple 060 grams, that would be 0.060 milligrams, but it would be more convenient to call this 60 micrograms, wouldn't it? And so it depends on the concentration. You know, percent concentration by mass, percent is called a part per hundred. Part per hundred is for fairly concentrated samples, part per hundred. And so if, you know, 75% by mass means that I have 75 grams per 100 grams. 75 grams of component A per 100 grams total. And so the mathematics of this, you know, most people are familiar with. You know, in decimal form, it would be 0.75. Is that right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, 0.75A over per total. And then we multiply this by 100% to get 75%. And so this is for concentrated samples or concentrated mixtures. But for very dilute mixtures, then this isn't so convenient. For dilute, or less concentrated samples, we might not want to use part per 100. So for example, if I had something like 0.071%, you know, a percent might not be the most convenient, you know. Although it's no big deal, 0.071%, you could still do that. You know. But if you have something like 0.071%, it might be more convenient to say this is 71 parts per 1,000. Or 71 ppt, I'll have to say 1,000, because ppt is usually trillion per 1,000. And so it might make it your life a little bit easier to call it part per 1,000, or might not, and just leave it. But the way we do that is this. You know, if we had something like this, 0.071% would be 0.071 grams out of 100 grams. Right? That's what it would be. That would be the percentage. Or it would be 0.00071. This would be A over total. This would be A over total. Or total is 1. And to convert this into a percent, what we do is we just multiply by 100%. We multiply by 100%, we're going to get 0.071%. That's 0.071%. But rather than multiplying by 100%, we have other options. So a couple of the most common ones, part per 1,000, is that very common? It turns out that's not so common. Probably the most common one is, rather than multiplying by 100, we could multiply this by 1,000,000. We multiply by 1,000,000, we call it a ppm. So we multiply by 1,000,000 ppm. If we multiply by 1,000,000, we're going to get, this is going to be 71,000 ppm A, which is equivalent to 0.071%. Does that make sense? And so this actually, you know, ppm is not so convenient here, percentage is not so convenient. A little part per 1,000 would have been perfect for this, but it's not so common. And so we'd probably just leave it that as percentage. But when it gets even more dilute, even less concentrated, we might have something like this. We might have something like 0.0015%. Well, that's very, very dilute. You know, this is trace quantities usually. And so in this example here, yeah, it's probably not the most convenient to use percent, you know, because this would be 0.0015 out of 100. And since this is by mass, we'll just do grams. So this would be grams of A over total grams. And so for every 100 grams, I have very little A, only 0.0015 grams of A. And so very dilute. However, you know, if I did this instead, you know, because this would be in fractional form as a percentage, in decimal form it would look like this, where it'd have six zeros. and a 1.5 grams of A over grams total. And so in this case, it might be easiest to do this, times a million ppm rather than 100%. If I times a million ppm, then I'm going to get, well, I just moved the decimal 6 over, I'm going to get, this is 15 ppm of A. The same thing, this would be 15 ppm of A. And so ppm is just like a percentage in the sense that you just multiply. Rather than multiplying by 100, we multiply by a million ppm. And so if I have 15 ppm A, what 15 ppm means is I have 15 parts, 15 grams of A for every million grams total. So if I had a million grams, only 15 of those would be A. It's a very, very low concentration. Or, you know, I might try to multiply, this is a million, a billion would be 10 to the 9th ppb. And so this would be 15,000 parts per billion, A. Or I could try multiplying by 10 to the 12th ppt, parts per trillion, which would be 15 million parts per trillion. Well, 15 million parts per trillion is not so convenient. PPTA. And so it's just, you know, depends on where you want the decimal point. But just like using metric prefixes, it just depends on where you want the decimal point, whether you use milli, micro, nano, and the same thing with part per hundred, part per million, part per trillion, etc., part per billion. So sometimes we'll have problems where we do that. And so this is a composition. Percentages aren't always by mass, you know. By mass is the most common. We have other percent compositions. And ppm, ppt. When I say percent, I'm also talking about ppm, ppt, ppb, all those, because those are all the same, same as percent. And so the types of percentages that we deal with are m over m. An m over m percent is by mass, you know. This would be mass of A over the total mass, you know, times 100%. We also have percent VV. VV is just volume of A over total volume. A is just a component of the mixture. There could be B, C, however many components you want. So this would be percent by volume. And then we have a MV percent. MV percent would just be a mass of A per volume total times 100%. And the same thing with part per million. We could have a M over M ppm, a V over V, an M over V. We could also have mole percent, you know, which would be like the mole. I forgot to mention this in the morning. Mole over mole. And so this is moles of A over total moles. That would be mole percent. And so water would be 67 mole percent hydrogen, 33 mole percent oxygen. Fixed ratio. So for stoichiometry, actually, I didn't want to erase this. So moles of A, I'm just going to do moles of B. So we might be given the grams of A. And depending on how concentrated it is, but typically these are fairly concentrated, so we'll use the percent composition by mass. This would be an M over M percent. But if it's dilute, we might have it in parts per million or parts per billion, whatever. Oops, wrong place. This is grams of A mixture. This is grams of pure A, sorry. Once I have puree, then. So if I have grams of a mixture, I could get this here. Or I might have something like the volume of A. This would be the volume of puree. So if I have the volume of pure A, then I just need the density here. So A might be a liquid, pure ethanol or something like that. Or I might have the volume of A mixture. If I have the volume of A mixture, then I would need the percent by volume here. Percent. This would be a V over V percentage composition. So if I know that. Or probably if I have a special mixture, an aqueous mixture, that is a water mixture, then probably the most common way of expressing the composition of that is by molarity. So if I know the molarity of that mixture, then I can figure out, based on the volume of the mixture, how many moles of puree I have in there. And so I can use molarity to go direct to that. And the same thing with B. I could go to grams of B over here. Or, you know, I could go to grams of B mixture. This would be grams of pure B. This would be B mixture. If I knew the percent composition of the mix. Or sometimes I'm interested in the percent composition of the mixture to solve for that. And so sometimes I'll go from grams of B to percent composition of the mix. The percent composition of the mix, it would be percent composition of B, which would be grams of B, which we just solved for grams of pure B, over grams total times 100%. We don't have to go to percent comp. We could go to part per million B, whatever, just by multiplying by a different factor there. And so let's take a look at some sample problems now and just see. Ninety-six is chalkboard chalk is made from calcium carbonate and calcium sulfate with minor impurities such as SiO2. SiO2 is known as silicon dioxide or silicon four oxide or coarse. Only the calcium carbonate reacts with dilute HCl. So the calcium sulfate and the quartz don't react with hydrochloric acid. What is the mass percent of calcium carbonate in a piece of chalk if a 3.28 gram sample yields 0.981 grams of CO2? All right, they give us the balanced chemical equation here. And so I have pure CO2 there. So I got 0.981 grams of pure CO2. We'll call that A. So we go from grams of CO2, pure, to moles of CO2. And from moles of CO2, they're asking us for calcium carbonate. All that CO2 came from the calcium carbonate. And so we could go to moles of calcium carbonate to grams of calcium carbonate. And so now we have grams of pure calcium carbonate. But they're asking us for the percent composition here. So we need the grams of calcium carbonate up top divided by the total grams, which is given, 3.28 times 100%. That'll give us the percent composition of the chalk. Chalkboard chalk. And so let's set that one up and do the calculation for that here. So this is a special kind of mixture in which there's only one reactive component and the others are inert. So you don't have to worry about any other reactions. So for number 96, we're going to start out 0.981 grams of CO2, carbon dioxide gas. Then what we want to do is we want to convert that to moles. So a mole of CO2 from earlier weighs 44.01 grams. So we get grams of CO2 cancels. Moles of CO2. And for every mole of CO2, we're going to have one mole of calcium carbonate forms. So one mole of CO2. And then calcium carbonate, what's the molar mass of that? So calcium, you can look that up over here, is going to be 40.08. I'm going to round it again. So calcium is 40.08. Carbon is 1201, and 3 oxygens is 48.04. Let's see if I have a better pen.
100.09.
Okay. And so there are 100.09 grams of calcium carbonate in the mole. And so this gives us pure calcium carbonate, but they aren't asking us how many grams of pure calcium carbonate. They want how many grams of mixture we have. Or they don't, actually, I'm sorry, they don't even want the grams of mixture. They want the percent by mass calcium carbonate in chalkboard chalk. And so here I'm going to get the grams of calcium carbonate. And what I'm going to do here is, rather than calculate an intermediate answer here, I'm going to set it up as one equation. And if I stop here and calculate, because I'm not quite done, so what I'll have is grams of calcium carbonate over 3.28 grams of mixture. I don't have to set it up in one equation. I'm just setting it up in one equation so I don't have any intermediate answers. If you carry all the digits in your calculator, you know, this will just save you having to write an intermediate answer down on paper. Because I could calculate them separately, but I'm not. I'll just calculate it all at once. 0.981 divided by 44.01 times 100.09 divided by 3.28 times 100. So I get 68.0, I'm allowed 3 sig figs, so I'll carry one extra, 68.01% calcium carbonate in this. And that comes from this. In the 3.28 grams of mixture, how many grams of calcium carbonate do I have? So I'm going to just redo the top, just the numerator. And so 0.981 divided by 44.01 times 100.09. Out of this 3.28, 2.23 grams of it is calcium carbonate, and so the rest is inert, calcium sulfate and quartz. So this is a mixture type stoichiometry problem. You've done something similar to this, probably an intro case. Now, some of the stoichiometry problems are going to involve solutions, you know, chemical reactions and solutions. So we need the composition of the solution. And so a lot of these problems are talking about, you know, molarity. Molarity is the most convenient because goes straight from volume, which is easy to measure for a solution, to moles of pure reactant or pure solute. It could be reactant or product. And so there's some review problems on solutions. Definition of molarity is mole per liter. And so calculate the molarity. So we have 2.92 moles of, what's this called, CH3OH? What that's called? Methanol in 7.16 liters. So if it's 2.92 divided by 7.16, that's the molarity. We also have millimoles per milliliter. A millimole per milliliter is the same thing as a mole per liter. Mole per liter. And so this is the molarity of, what's this? Ethanol. And then we have 25.2 grams of CONH22. What's this called? What's this one called? This one we're not responsible for because this is a different organic functional group. So we aren't going to worry about making this because this is beyond what we're expecting. The only organics we need to know how to name are, you know, hydrocarbons and alcohols and of oxalic acid. We don't need to know how to name this type of compound.
So what's the name?
Yeah, what is it?
This is a, well, this organic functional group is called amide, amide. And so it has a certain way of naming it. But, you know, a lot of these organics, they have common names, you know. For example, this one, C12H2211. What's C12H2211 called? Sucrose. You know, but it also has a systematic name, which is too much. This is a classic of organic called carbohydrates, carbon and hydrogen oxygen. The hydrogen and oxygen is a 2-to-1 ratio, like water, so it's carbohydrate. This one is more commonly known by its common name rather than its systematic name. Do you know what the common name for this is?
Urea.
So this is 25.2 grams of urea in 275 milliliters. So what we do is we convert grams to moles and then milliliters to liters and divide. Right? We get molarity.
Where is urea usually found in?
In waste, human waste.
That's usually found. I started to make that
clear. Also, it's also found in space, you know. There are certain organic carbon molecules that they've found. Well, maybe it's found in space, you know, because what they did was they take, you know, urea was the first organic made from inorganics. Did you hear about this? Yeah. This is something you learn in geology as well. But, you know, in this, whatever they call it, the primordial soup, or, you know, there's CO2, which is an inorganic, water, and other things. Where did organic chemicals come from? Well, one of the ideas, one of the hypotheses, or one of the theories is that, you know, lightning strike and other stuff caused the reaction of inorganics to form urea. And so urea was the first organic formed strictly from inorganics. And then from urea, you can build other organics. This is not urea. This is acetone, CH3. And this is also called dimethyl ketone, you know, if you want to know. But
that was that experiment that was made in a concealed tube.
Yeah, exactly.
The electricity.
Right. That's an electricity.
But anyway, here, urea. Now, this is not. This is now a mixture, you know, 97.9%. So if 98.3 milligrams of 97.9% pure solid is dissolved, that's not a pure solid. This is a mixture. And so out of this 98.3 grams, only 97.9% of that is urea. And so we've got to figure out, this is a total gram, so we need to figure out the, Yeah, we need to figure out how many of this is actually urea. And we could do that by percent composition. So we see percent composition pop up, even in molarity problems. We see percent composition pop up, and we see this pop up too. In many communities, water is fluoridated to prevent tooth decay. In the United States, for example, more than half of the population served by public water systems has access to water that is fluoridated approximately 1 milligram fluoride per liter. A milligram per liter is a very well-known unit. Have you ever heard that? This is very dilute. 1 milligram in a liter is very dilute, isn't it? A milligram per liter, you know what that's also called? A milligram per liter is called a... A milligram per liter is also called a ppm. A ppm is known as a milligram per liter, milligram of solute per liter of solution, or it's also known as a microgram of solute dissolved in a milliliter of solution. All these are ppm. You can see that they're ppm by just looking at the ratio or the fraction here. Like if I had a milligram of solute, so a milligram of A, we'll call it. A liter is how many milliliters?
One thousandth of a liter?
Yeah, 1,000 milliliters. How many grams is 1,000 milliliters of solution? If it's very dilute, we assume it's close to pure water. And so this is going to be about a milligram of A for about 1,000 grams of solution. A milligram is how many grams? A milligram is 0.001 gram, right? That's a 1 milligram per 1,000 grams. So let's move the decimal three places over. There are different ways I could have done this. I could have just had milligram per milligram. Maybe that would have been easier. And so if I move this one three places over, that means I have 1 gram of A per million grams of solution. Hey, 1 gram of A per million grams of solution is a ppm. PPM. Or if I left it milligrams, you know, I'd have 1 milligram of A, and 1,000 grams is how many milligrams? If I had 1,000 grams, how many milligrams is that? It's a million. And so this would be 1 milligram per million milligrams of total solution. So this is a ppm. The same thing here, microgram per milliliter. Microgram per milliliter is another unit. These two units you see all the time, milligrams per liter and micrograms per milliliter, when you're dealing with dilute mixtures. And those are just ppm. And so this is just 1 ppm should be the level of fluoridation. This sample contains 1.2 ppm fluoride. And so, you know, normally, well, what's the molarity of that? And so if I have 1.2 ppm fluoride, how many moles per liter is that? What's the molarity of the fluoride? And so if I have 1.2 ppm, then that, all that means is I have 1.2 grams of fluoride per million grams of solution. And so all I have to do here is convert grams to moles, and then grams of solution to liters of solution. So I'll probably go milliliters of solution, assuming a density. We have to do this. Assume that the density is close to water. Pure water. And it should be close. I mean, it's very dilute. If it were concentrated, we can't. If this were percent composition, we can't assume the density is close to water because that's a highly concentrated solution. But if it's a highly dilute solution, then we can make this assumption here and then convert this to liters. And then we get moles per liter. If the solution is more concentrated, we need additional information in order to solve the particular problem. And so let's take a look at 36B. When we look at 36B, concentrated hydrochloric acid solution, 36.0% HCl by mass. Can we assume that the density of 36% HCl by mass is close to pure water? 1 gram per milliliter? No, we can't assume that. In fact, if we look at the density is a lot greater. It's like 18% higher. It's 1.18 grams per milliliter. There's 0.18 grams of extra junk in there per milliliter. You see that? And so here we can't make that assumption, but when we're dealing with ppm and ppb and ppt, we can make that assumption because it's very dilute. Does that make sense? Okay. So if we're doing this particular problem here, you know, we get 36.0% HCl by mass, then, you know, it's the same type of problem as this. You know, I know what a ppm is, I know what a ppt is. It's 36 grams, actually 36.0. 36.0 grams of pure HCl per 100 grams of solution, the mixture. And so here, grams of HCl to moles of HCl, that's easy. Here, grams of solution to milliliters of solution, We're going to have to use the density here. The density is 1.18 grams per milliliter. We'll flip it over. And then milliliters of solution to liters of solution. That's easy. That's 1,000 milliliters per liter.
So we should be able to interconvert between the units, molarity, percentages, etc. And the same thing here. If you look at this, sucrose is highly concentrated, therefore they've got to give us the density here, which they did, 1.21. It's 46% sugar solution here. Ethanol, you know, this is 11% ethanol by mass, so they give us the density here because it's highly concentrated. Fluoride, they didn't give us a density there. We just have to assume it. Okay. All right, those are molarity percent composition type problems. Now, we're going to do some problems in which we're going to use molarity or percent composition in one way or the other. And so number 66, let's take a look at that here. All right, this is, this in a way is a mixture, but it's not the type of mixture that we've been talking about, because this is just two reactants, you know. How many grams of hydrogen are produced by the reaction of 1.84 grams of aluminum with 75.0 milliliters, 2.95 molar HCl? Recall equation 4.2. And so these are just the two reactants, but in a way, it is a mixture, but not a mixture in the sense that we were looking at before. So as we recall, two aluminum, six HCl, gives us two AlCl3s plus three H2 gas. This is the balance equation we had up there earlier. And so if I have 1.84 grams of aluminum solid, and then 75.0 milliliters of 2.95 molar HCl, it's a different kind of mixture than what we saw before. The mixtures that we saw before, we had two reactants which yielded independent reactions, or, you know, we had one reactant with inert stuff, and we didn't worry about the other reactants in the equation because we assumed we had excess. Here, when I see this type of mixture, I automatically think of what? When you see this kind of mixture, you should automatically think this is a limiting reactant problem. This is a limiting reactant mixture. Now we're giving different amounts of this. And so limiting reactant, everybody's done those, I assume. And so the way I like to do it is by the smaller amount method. And so which one of these two reactants yields a smaller amount? And so what we're going to do is we're going to look at the yield of hydrogen. Yield of hydrogen from aluminum first, and then from the HCl. And so the yield of hydrogen from aluminum is 1.84 grams of aluminum solid. And then we just go grams of aluminum to moles of aluminum. 26.98 grams. Moles of aluminum, moles of hydrogen, 3 moles of hydrogen per 2 moles of aluminum. And then moles of aluminum to grams of hydrogen to grams, moles of hydrogen to grams of hydrogen. That's it. Okay, so go ahead and calculate what we should get from that.
Okay.
How many grams of hydrogen
do you get from this? Point 2 0. Don't round it.
2 0 6 2.
0.2062.
Yeah.
Thanks. Grams of hydrogen. Is that how much we're going to get? We don't know, because we don't know if we have enough HCl. And so what we're going to do is we're going to calculate the yield of hydrogen from HCl. Well, HCl is a mixture here. And so what we have is we have the volume of the mixture, 75.0 milliliters of HCl solution of the mixture. And then we'll just convert that to liters. A liter is 1,000 milliliters. And so if we have liters of solution, we know the molarity, then it's easy. It's 2.95 moles of pure HCl per liter of mixture or liter of solution. And so this gives us how many moles of pure HCl we have in here. And then we know that it's 3-to-6 ratio, 3 moles of hydrogen for every 6 moles of HCl. Then the molar mass, 2.016 grams of hydrogen per mole of hydrogen. Okay, how much does this give? We get 75 times 2.95. Oops, divided by 1,000. What did you get? 0.2230. We'll just carry one extra. We're only allowed 3 6 figs. All right, now, how much hydrogen will we get? Will we get 0.2062 or 0.223, or do we add those two together? How much? In the previous mixtures, we would have added the two together because each one produced independently one of another, but these aren't independent reactions. These are dependent reactions. And what that means is that once all the aluminum's reacted, then we're left with 0.2062. We can't generate more hydrogen than that. It's a smaller amount. The smaller amount is what we call the, smaller amount, theoretical yield. And so in theory, this is the maximum amount we're going to get, theoretical yield. Because once we hit the theoretical yield, we've consumed all of the aluminum, which is called the limiting reagent. This is our limiting reagent, LR, limiting reagent, or reactant. Both mean the same thing. Which means not all the HCl is going to react. Now, the HCl here is called the excess reagent. And so some of the HCl is going to be left over as excess. And so we have more than required, which is typical. When you do a reaction, you usually add more of one than the other. And so in this case, we want to react all the aluminum. We don't want any left over, so we're just going to add some excess HCl. Get all the aluminum to react and to form this amount of hydrogen gas. All right, there are two other things that we are interested in. And one is the percent yield and the actual yield. How do I get the how do I get the percent yield? Yeah, I need to be given something. You know, let's say I do this. I take 1.84 grams of aluminum, I take this amount of HCl, and I react it. Then I try to capture all the hydrogen that's generated. Let's say, unfortunately, I didn't get all of it. I lost a little bit of it. And so let's say in experiment A, I did this. Experiment A, I was able to capture 0.2043 0.03 grams of hydrogen. In theory, I should have gotten 0.2062 because those are the amount of chemicals I reacted. But I lost a tiny bit. I lost like a milligram, 2 milligrams maybe, close to 2 milligrams worth, which is not much, right? But a little bit. And so this is what we call the actual yield. The actual yield. And then I repeated this, let's say in experiment B. In experiment B, I accidentally lost more. So let's say I ended up with 0.1502 grams of hydrogen. Same amounts of chemicals, so I should have, in theory, have gotten 0.206, I only got this much. So this is actual yield. And so let's compare the experiment A went pretty good. In experiment B, I lost some. I lost quite a lot. And so what we can do to characterize these two experiments is to calculate something called the percent yield. The percent yield is the actual yield, how much you actually got in the experiment, divided by the theoretical yield times 100%. And so in the first experiment, I didn't lose much, just a fingerprint's worth, which is nothing. So you got a point to 2043 divided by 0.2062 times 100. So this comes out to 99.07%. I think it could have done better than that even, about 99.1%. But in experiment B, which didn't go so well, the percent yield here is 0.1502 over the theoretical, which is 0.2062 grams of hydrogen times 100%. And so let's see what that comes out to as far as percent yield. 0.1502 divided by 0.2062. And this comes out to 72.8, so 4%. And so I got a much better yield. You know, try to get an even higher yield, but you know, there's so little amount, you know, product. And so this was pretty good, and this was good, but maybe it's still not bad. It depends on the reaction, you know. Like for example, you know, you always try to maximize the yield, but sometimes it's tough. Are we out of time? Almost 5 more minutes? All right. Sometimes it's tough, you know, because to scrape out every little bit, let's say you're supposed to get 1.328 grams of precipitate. To scrape out every little bit of precipitate would take you a lot of extra time. This is like, let's say you're vacuuming your rug, and you want to get every single speck of dust off your rug. You know, every single speck of dust off your rug. And you're going to take a magnifying glass to it. You know, is it worth the time? No, you'd probably go, okay, 95%, that's plenty, right? Well, the same thing in chemical reactions. Some chemical reactions, you know, you lose a little bit here, lose a little bit there. It's okay. We're just going to do that. And so sometimes what you'll do is you'll optimize it. Like say you're vacuuming the rug, you've optimized your procedure, you can do it quickly and still get a 95% yield. You'll sacrifice that 5% because that remaining 5% would be too cost prohibitive to get, right? And the same thing in chemical reactions. You know, there are some chemical reactions that, you know, you kind of optimize it, or there are other factors that influence it, and so they have kind of a predicted yield, you know. So in this case, we have a reaction here, and they're predicting the yield. They're going to predict the 78.2% yield because that's kind of a typical yield for this reaction. Does that make sense? And so it's like this. You do the same thing. Like, for example, if you need 100 cookies for some party, but you like to eat, you know, while you're making them, you like to eat 3 of them, then are you going to make 100 and then eat 3 and end up with only 97? No, you're going to predict you're going to eat 3 of them, maybe 4 of them, and then you'll compensate for that, right? And so the same thing here. You know, if we need 100 grams of this chemical, and we predict I'm going to lose about this much, then you have to compensate for that loss. And so this is what this problem is about here. How many grams of commercial acetic acid must be allowed to react with an excess of PCl3 to produce 75 grams of acetyl chloride? So this is your 75 cookies that you want, but you're going to lose about 20% of those. And so you need to make extra. And so in this particular problem, we'll do that. Let me just, we have a minute left. And so the 75 grams, these are some shortcuts that we can do since we're out of time. You've got 75 grams of acetyl chloride. One of the shortcuts is use abbreviations like this, especially when you've got chemicals like this. And so we go from grams of acetyl chloride to moles of acetyl chloride. And so you just have to get the molar mass of acetyl chloride. They give us the formula. This is acetyl chloride here. And then we go from moles of acetyl chloride to moles of acetic acid. But they said this is not balanced, but all the carbon in acetic acid ends up in acetyl chloride. So if I have two carbons here, I gotta have two carbons here. So it's a 1-to-1 ratio. I don't have to worry about anything else. And so this saves me a lot of time. It's like the phosphorus here. All the phosphorus ends up in phosphoric acid. Oh, this is not, this is phosphorus acid. And so it's gotta be a 1-to-1 mole ratio. Do you see that? And so if the carbon here ends up in multiple products, then it's screwed. We can't figure it out by this method. But all the carbon ends up here, so it's going to be a 1-to-1 mole ratio. So I can go to moles of acetyl chloride, which will be the same as the moles of acetic acid, ACAC. And then from moles of acetic acid, I can go to grams of pure acetic acid. But you know what? I'm not even using pure acetic acid. I'm using commercial acetic acid. Commercial acetic acid is only 97%. Acetic acid. And so here, I have to go from grams of acetic acid to grams of commercial acetic acid. And so what we're going to do is we're going to look at the conversion factors for this next time, since we're out of time now. But the conversion factors, people get them flipped all the time. Let's take a look.
Can I show you?
Yeah, let's take a look at that.